Hello and welcome to Newsclick's International Roundup. Today, we look at key developments in Iran and Afghanistan, which may have major implications on the entire planet. To talk more about this, we have with us Prabir Purkayastha, Editor-in-Chief, Newsclick. Hello, Prabir. Prabir, let's start with Iran. So, Iran is still in the grip of sanctions, the US sanctions. And payment has been one of the key issues around these sanctions. So, the SWIFT payment mechanism, which is basically dominated by the United States, has been a major roadblock in overcoming any sanctions. And after a lot of sounds and after a lot of noise, the United Kingdom, Germany, and France have finally inaugurated their own payment mechanism called INSTEX. Now, do you see this as actually having a major impact on the whole situation, or is it just a token mechanism?
You know, let's put it this way. As far as the INSTEX immediate fallout may be, that may not be of major implications because the big entities who could trade with Iran within Germany, France, and other European EU countries would be scared to do so because of their much bigger market or links with the United States. Right. So therefore, those who could or would be able to trade with Iran would be smaller players. But the importance of this is also the visibility of trying to work out an alternate to the dollar. Because if you look at earlier sanctions, which was the response of Russians to that, was to create their own payment gateway. Right. Which would allow an alternative to the SPFS, which would allow an alternate mechanism to the SWIFT. Now, what really is the SWIFT system? The SWIFT system was originally a European one. They opened one of their nodes to be in the United States, and they had two major nodes. And the SWIFT system, therefore, came under the US law. Right. That's what the US said. Because you have a major node in the United States, you have to operate under our law. Therefore, the SWIFT system has also to respond or has to accept whatever sanction regime the US is introducing. So what happened was that if you did any transaction with any country using the dollar and you used the SWIFT system, the US really had two, shall we say, ways it could say the US sanctions had to work. One is the dollar is being used, therefore, obviously, you know, it's a US currency. And secondly, because of the SWIFT transaction that is taking place with that dollar, that is also under US law. So this is the way they have been able to introduce what I would call as extra legal sanctions in the world, which means international law is not used, only US domestic law. So US domestic law has become the basis of the US sanctions, and it becomes global sanctions because most countries or almost all countries, when they denominate their external payments, they denominate in dollar rather than in SDRs or euros and any other currency. And because of the SWIFT system and the dollar being both under US sanctions, therefore US law in this sense superseded international law. And in fact, the US could also say, I don't accept the international law. And if they want sanctions, I can still violate it. So this created, shall we say, an anomaly in the international legal system. And this was really because dollar was the de facto gold standard, shall we say, after the US went off gold. And once the US has been acting in this manner outside the international legal framework, then countries are now trying to de-dollarize in different ways. One is, of course, oil. Oil was pegged to the dollar. And when it went off the gold standard, oil is the one which gave dollar the ability to be the international currency. Now you have one of the three largest producers of hydrocarbons in the world, Russia, Iran, and now Venezuela under sanctions. Exactly. Now, here is the problem for countries like India. If we buy oil from Iran, we are under sanctions. If we don't, then we have the problem of how much can we buy and at what cost. So this has created a need for alternate mechanisms. And now with the SPFS as well as the INSTEX, alternate de-dollarized international exchanges are being considered. And I think this is a very serious threat to the dollar in the long run. And don't forget, gold is still there. Right. So Venezuela is selling now gold. United Arab Emirates is buying gold. And even Russia, when it has used in its hydrocarbon account, gas which it sells to Europe and so on, where it buys, it sort of buys the dollars in lieu of gas, it very quickly converts it to gold. Right. So both Russia and China, accepting that there's a long-term threat of US sanctions, of course Russia is still already under sanctions, but even China, there is also the move away from dollar, not keeping their money in dollar, but trying to shift to gold. So already we are seeing different moves away from the currency, the dollar as an international currency. And I think in the global hegemony that the US exercised over the whole world, by which it considered itself outside international law, Bolton is on record that he doesn't recognize international law, international criminal court is something which is illegal according to him. He's also threatened right now Maduro to that they will send them off to Gitpo, which incidentally is in Cuba, and is also illegally occupied by the United States. So this whole logic of exceptionalism of the United States, I think that is starting to unravel. Would be wrong to think it has unraveled, it has not. But I think the portents are very important, that already you can see this unraveling of the dollar hegemony, which started after the Second World War as a pact between Saudi Arabia and the United States, that they will see that all petroleum trade deal would be in dollars, which is what really underpinned the petroleum dollar economy. I think that is starting to unravel. And that, I think, is a very, very important issue.
And we already discussed this before, but this is yet another instance of countries having to make some hard choices. Like it was Venezuela last week when the UK seized its gold reserves, the US imposed its sanctions. And then so many countries right now have to ask this question, what happens if their policies fall foul of the US and its allies? Its entire economic system and its trade system could actually go into doldrums. So.
And also the countries who trade with such countries, right, exactly, who fall foul of the US, exactly, but who are dependent on really, right, in most cases, hard choices regarding hydrocarbons. Right. European Union for gas, which comes from Russia, India for oil, as well as other countries for Venezuelan oil. So all these are actually the ones driving it. And you know, the other part of it, which I think has also been not been noted, though it's peripheral to this discussion, is the fact that Russia and Iran have diversified their economy to an extent that they are not so dependent on external trade. And because oil is what everybody else needs, and hydrocarbon is, or gas in this case, is what everybody else needs, therefore they can exchange for hard currency, right, but internally they are self-sufficient in a whole range of things. Right. And that's the strength the Iranian economy and the Russian economy has, which Venezuelan economy today, yes, does not have. It's much more dependent on oil.
And moving to the other country in the region, Afghanistan. So there has been rumors of a deal, which in fact has been also announced, although the details are not clear yet, between the United States and the Taliban, which would see the United States withdrawing gradually from Afghanistan in return for there not being space for terrorists, so-called terrorists, in Afghanistan itself. Now, this deal is still very, very murky because the Taliban does not seem to, say, be ready to negotiate with the Afghan government, which is a key stumbling block for the whole process. But this basically, in some senses, also negates the whole point of the war in 2000, that began in 2001. So 17 or 18 years later, we are back to square one. And now it looks like it might be processes led by Russia or Iran, which might actually bring further peace to the region.
You know, if we look at Afghanistan, and I have said this, I think, in our discussions earlier, it's a very rugged country. Right. It's a very hostile landscape for any invading power, particularly for an invading power which is thousands of kilometers away.
Right.
So this really did not seem a very wise decision, shall we say, for the United States to invade Afghanistan. Why did it do so? Because it broke Afghanistan in the 80s, trying to break Soviet Union, and therefore had this supported this mullah-led, right, insurgency, which was essentially a, shall we say, Saudi Arabia, Pakistan, ISI, and United States fomenting, using religious identity, not religion, religious identity as a move against a secular government, whatever may be the differences within that government or we others may have. It was a secular government. And Afghanistan had always a relatively secular state. Unraveling all of that, putting these forces in power, and then complaining that they were doing exactly what they always said they would do, which is to spread Islam with the sword, which is what they, what they had come to Afghanistan for, and they had come in large numbers from Saudi Arabia, Pakistan, and other places. And Taliban was again something, as it has been said, you know, the Talibs were all being produced out of Pakistan seminaries, which were run by these radical clerics. Now, it's a problem for Afghanistan, it's a problem for Pakistan, it's a problem for Iran, it's a problem for India. It's also a problem for Central Asia. It's a problem for China as well, because China also has a restive Uyghur population. So all of this is the problem that the United States created for the region, which Trump says they should solve the problem. Yes, but the problem was created by the United States. Of course, the regional parties have to solve the problem. So I'm happy at one level that the United States, which has no business being in Afghanistan, is actually thinking of withdrawing. I'm also happy that the United States at least is talking about withdrawal from Syria, even though it has not. And in fact, it's put in few more soldiers while talking about withdrawal. If we take the long-term trajectory, it does appear that the United States now thinks it needs to disengage for its, shall we say, interventions in Afghanistan, Iraq, Libya, and Syria, the four countries which they have intervened. So all these interventions in the long term seems to be something that the United States may be getting out of. The only problem is that having or thinking about getting out of that is also focusing their attention on South America. And therefore, you see now a regime change operation in Venezuela and rewiring the whole Latin American states. So Nicaragua could be target, El Salvador could be target, Cuba would be target, Bolivia would be target. Already they have had a regime change ruling Lula out of the Brazilian.
And Honduras for that matter.
Honduras for that matter earlier. So Zelaya was removed. So all of these means that their focus could be shifting to Latin America and away from West Asia. So this is one thing that will happen. I think also it's important to understand that Afghanistan and Taliban does represent threats to the region of different kinds. Iran, we know that Iran was earlier a target of Taliban. We know that, you know, 21 Iranian diplomats were killed by one section of the Afghan militants. We know that there is a strong link between fundamentalist, as I call them, Islamic identity-based forces in Pakistan. And we know that they're also hostile to India. So, and we've also discussed Central Asia and other places. So how does India, Iran, Pakistan, China, Russia, and other Central Asian countries move to stabilize the region, I think is going to be very important. And if any of the countries want to play a one-upmanship role, or what is called zero-sum game role, my gain is your loss, so your loss must be my gain, I think Afghanistan is almost impossible to control. I think the important issue is, what is it India, Pakistan, Iran are willing to do together, even if they have differing interests among themselves? Obviously, the Chabahar port is an outlet for Afghanistan. So both India and Iran have an interest in that. It gives, through Iran, it gives India an access to Afghanistan, which it otherwise doesn't have. So all these things mean a collaborative exercise between Iran and India as well. And I think Pakistan would also benefit if Iran, Pakistan, and India pull in together. As one of the Iranian diplomats had said privately, that while Taliban is a threat to Iran and India's security, for Pakistan, it's an existential threat. And I think the Pakistan state and the Pakistan military, which really is the quote-unquote deep state in Pakistan, understands this.
Thank you, Prabir. That's all we have time for today. Keep watching Newsclick.